Hey, everybody. We're the Epic Game Store. I want to welcome everyone. Thank you for coming. We're very excited. Hope you've had a great GDC so far. Today, we're going to be taking you through a couple different things. I want to just move this along real quick. Hold on. There we go. Cool. So you'll see there Steve Allison, Kyle Billings, Melissa Hill, and John Kopp. I am John Kopp. And today, we're going to take you through a couple different things. We're going to start off with State of the Store from our friend Steve. We're going to move on to product features and development, then self-publishing and release management. We'll wrap up with promotions, merchandising, and channel marketing. And then we'll go into a Q&A. So again, I'll hand it off to Steve to get things started.
All right. Hey, everybody. Thank you for coming out. At the risk of being repetitive to some stuff we did this morning, I more or less have said everything I'm going to say here this morning in State of Unreal. But if you missed it, you're going to get it for the first time. And if you saw it, sorry. When we succeed, you succeed. This is a mantra that we use across Epic. It's pretty much what drives us at the store and all of our other partner businesses in Unreal Engine, UEFN, and Epic Online Services. And I just want to give you kind of the state of where we're at as we closed out 2023. So 270 million PC accounts, 75 million monthly active users, and we closed the year with $950 million in player spending, which was up about 16% year over year. For our players, if you're not already a partner of ours or you don't use the store yet, we have two main value propositions beyond buying and acquiring content is that we give, as a UA vehicle, we give free games away to our players weekly that are free to keep forever. It's been an amazingly powerful user acquisition tool for us with a high conversion rate to paid. Epic Rewards is the other. It's a first of its kind loyalty program, and I'm going to talk a little bit about both. All right, free games. We gave 80 away last year. They're worth about $2,000, and our players get to keep those forever. It's an incredible value proposition for the people that use our store religiously. And for people who are developers and publishers who are releasing games, it's an incredible tool because they convert to paid at about 30% on average. And the cost per new user is pretty incredible. So we continue to do it. You can expect us to continue to do it for years to come. Epic Rewards is something that we launched last May. It's the first of its kind loyalty program on PC where we give 5% back on all qualifying purchases, which is pretty much everything that uses our payment rail, including purchases in Fortnite. And players accrue their Epic Rewards funds in a promotional wallet, which they can then use at their discretion to purchase your games. Where we are today, just after having the program live for 9 months, we have well over $60 million in player purchasing power ready to be unleashed for a corny term, unleashed into purchases and hopefully on your third-party games. If you've been with us, you know it. If you haven't, we launched the store in 2018 with an industry-leading 88-12 revenue share, with 88% of the revenue going to you, our publishers and developer partners. We also have programs where you can keep 100% of the revenue, which we launched throughout last year. One of the programs, which has been a policy that was not as well-known as we had hoped, but we've seen a lot of adoption recently, is that for in-app purchases, you can use your own payment processing services at your discretion. If you do so, all of your in-app purchases, you get to keep 100% of the revenue, or you can wire up to ours and pay a 12% fee. We have two opt-in programs that we launched last October that are slightly different, but basically as a result in the same thing, which is 100% of the revenue for the first 6 months of your title's launch on the Epic Game Store is going to you. You have Epic First Run, which is an opt-in exclusivity program for 6 months. And for those 6 months afterwards, you get 100% of the revenue on the store. And then for publishers and developers who have back catalog that they've launched on Steam or other PC stores, as long as you bring three titles or more, every launch that you bring while the program is active, which runs until the end of next year, you receive 100% of the revenue for the first 6 months after launching those on the Epic Game Store. If you guys are Unreal Engine developers, or you have them as a publisher, you have them in your stable of titles, and you have a royalty-bearing deal with our Unreal Engine team, all of your sales on the Epic Game Store are engine royalty-free. One of the messages from this morning, which is really the reason I was at State of Unreal, was we've been fighting tirelessly for the last few years against mobile platform gatekeepers to allow for distribution that is more fair, more open, and really built for the way we need to run our businesses today and going forward in the future. We've made a ton of positive progress this past year, but the battle is far from over. We have more to do. That being said, I'm excited to announce today, we did it this morning, I'll do it here for you in case you missed it, that we are working hard, aggressively, and at a pace that is, I would say, is a full speed ahead to bring the Epic Game Store to mobile on iOS and Android before the end of this year. And we're excited to be leading the charge and bringing Fortnite back to mobile, along with a selection of our third-party partners that have expressed interest in bringing their mobile games to the store when we launch. As we expand into mobile platforms, EGS will become the first ever game-focused multi-platform store that will work across Android, iOS, PC, and Mac, and will be anchored by our players' accounts. Everything I talked about in the slides leading up to this one remains in place for mobile, so that means all the 100% programs, the ability to use your own payments, and along with that, we'll be launching self-publishing tools when we release later in the year, and we'll have more information on the exact dates in the months ahead. And on that, I will pass it off to Kyle, who's way more prepared than I was for this opening, and I apologize for being a little sloppy. Thank you for coming.
Cool. Thanks, Steve.
Sorry about that.
The two sons of Tatooine. I can still see familiar faces, so hey guys. I'm Kyle Billings, Director of Strategy and Business Operations for the Epic Game Store. I'm going to run through a bunch of stuff we've done over the last year, and I'm going to give you a glimpse into the next 18 to 24 months, and not going to talk about mobile, because that's saving that for a few months from now. So if we take a step back, like, we really believe that a competitive PC marketplace is crucial for players and for partners. When we provide developers with distribution options, it gives players the choice where they want to buy games. It's almost like you're voting with your wallet, and it encourages all the platforms to strive for their best. We do acknowledge, like, we have ground to make up. 24 and 25 are really focused on enhancing the player experience. First, I want to just quickly run through some of the things that we launched last year. So around GDC, if you guys recall, we introduced self-publishing tools, a way to onboard, self-distribute your games, which enabled our partners to manage the full life cycle of their products. Throughout 2024, we're continuing to enhance these tools. We're adding more supported product configurations, and we are migrating our partners from the legacy tooling that they were on to self-publishing. Later in the year, we launched the discount management tool. John is going to talk at length about that, so I'm just going to say, like, hey, this is great. And then finally, we launched Epic Rewards. Of my view, this is one of the coolest things that exists on PC. First of its kind on PC, gives 5% back to players. Epic pays for this, and the players can use that money at their discretion against future purchases. Taking a broader view, the things that we got done last year, you know, this summarizes kind of like everything we've done over the last 15 months. So this is a two-sided marketplace that we have to deal with, and so we have to cater to both groups. Over the last couple years, our primary focus has been the developer experience and maximizing the number of games our players can find, right? Because, like, if we build a ton of player-facing features, but there's no content for them to buy, like, why would they be there? So we attacked the content side first, and now we're attacking the player-facing side. So over the next 18 months, the whole goal is to connect players with the games that they want and just overall enhance the player experience. I'm definitely not covering everything on this list today because we don't have time, but you can find me in the hall or at any of the million events this week and ask me all the questions you want. I will talk about four things that I am extremely excited about, though. All right, first is on the left, our enhanced and improved download manager. I don't know, maybe it's just me, but, like, it's been a real gap with the being able to manage your queue, schedule downloads, timeout things. It has everything that you would expect, and I think more, from a download manager. I have said that it has all the things I never knew I always wanted. So I'm excited that you guys will get to check this out in just a few months. And then on the right is the new homepage header module. This enables our merch team to really showcase, like, important new releases, in-game events, major store events, and, you know, bluntly, it's beautiful. So hats off to the design team. On the left, we now have enhanced store navigation, or secondary nav. This is crucial for content discovery. making an overall more seamless experience for players trying to find things, for us to showcase some of the news and events that are happening, campaigns that are going on in the store. Improving discovery is a huge effort over the next 18 months. I think you guys will see a lot of new merchandising surfaces and pathways to get players from point A to in-game. And then on the left is the new carousel that we are introducing. So this is going to come later this year. Initially, it's going to be for sub-pages, sale landing pages, et cetera. But eventually, this is going to get elevated to the main Discover page as it becomes more established. Before we transition away from product to store migration, I do want to address some concerns voiced by our players. Like, we're actively addressing product gaps. Moving to mobile, this is the only sentence you get from me. Moving to mobile does not mean that we're forgetting about the PC store. Like, we are taking everything that we've been building from PC and we're just elevating it up. It also means that we're hardening a lot of the PC experience, making sure that the things that we are building now and the things we've built in the past can be taken to mobile. So I would never think to say like, oh, mobile is like the frontier that, and we're just forgetting about PC. Like, this is a true like one store, four platforms. All right, so we do have two requirements though. I'll address them really briefly. The first one is cross-store multiplayer. Players expect to be able to play with their friends, like irrespective of platform or storefront. So we need to make sure that like, if you are coming to the game, wait, hold on. Yes, okay, good. If you are coming to the Epic Game Store and you have a multiplayer solution, it has to work across both us and other PC storefronts. I encourage you to explore and use Epic Online Services, but it's not mandatory. Like, just make sure that whatever service you choose does not lock you into a walled garden. And then our submission checks regularly ensure that crossplay is working. Default matchmaking across PC storefronts and the ability to invite and play with your friends across storefronts. The other one is rewarding players with achievements, right? Some people are achievement hunters, some people aren't. Whether or not you are, that's up to you. But if you support achievements on other PC storefronts, you have to support them on EGS. It's a really straightforward process, so you can do it. The docs are right there. You allocate about 1,000 XP to the base game set. Additional XP can be added upon request, and then EGS achievements are built on top of EOS achievements, so enabling them is a really straightforward process. Oh, that's a new slide. That's what you talked about. If you'd like to learn more about Epic Online Services, you can check out their session Friday at 10 a.m. In this building. Okay, so going back, like rewinding to Unreal Fest and our announcement of Epic First Run, a successful two-sided marketplace requires the content and it requires the users, and they need to be able to find the things that they're looking for. Right? Your average player buys two games in a year. If they're only buying two games in a year and they look for they want that thing on the Epic Game Store and it's not there, they go somewhere else with, a larger rev share. Therefore, like, we need our partners to bring all these PC titles to the store for players to discover. So as Steve had called out 20 slides ago, Epic First Run is an opt-in exclusivity program. Bring your game to the Epic Storefront as a PC exclusive for the first 6 months. You'll benefit from a revenue boost from 88% to 100% of all user spending. And then with a really well-executed off-platform marketing strategy, direct your players to the Epic Game Store and like squeeze the lemon as hard as you can when it's most important, right? The first 6 months of your game are the most important. On the flip side of that, like the analog to this would be now on Epic. It serves as the counterpart to Epic First Run, right? We launched a store in 2018. We have a large catalog gap we have to fill. There's nebulous ROI in bringing your back catalog games over to a store, right? And we acknowledge that. So, and managing additional SKUs is some amount of work for some person. So we're hoping that we offset that risk that you're taking and the cost of doing that with bring over your catalog. First 6 months, we'll take no rev share. The boost from 88 to 100% as well. You can collaborate really closely with our teams. You can do franchise sales. You can do launch discounts. John will talk about all that in the marketing bits. But you can really maximize those first 6 months on the store. that's really the end of it for me. As I said, like, feel free. I'm around all the time. I'll be at every UE Fest this year. I'll be at a bunch of other conferences. Please chat with me if you have any questions about anything. But you know, we're 5 years in, and our mission hasn't changed, right? Like, we're here to stay. We're not going anywhere. Like, and this team has, almost the entire team has been here since the inception of the store. And we are dedicated to this thing. Like, I want to build a storefront that excites people and is great, game-changing with respect to PC and mobile distribution. And we can get there, but we need our partners to also ship their games. And we invite you to just continue to be on this journey with us. And to that, it's Melissa's turn.
Good afternoon, GDC. My name is Melissa Hill, and I work on the Epic Game Store, leading a fierce force of partner managers and coordinators who are passionate and dedicated to helping developers and publishers distribute their products on the Epic Game Store. This time last year, the store launched publishing tools designed to enable partners to self-serve in onboarding, promoting, launching, and updating their products on the store. Today, nearly 60% of our total catalog represents base products distributed by partners using SPT, our self-publishing tool, a resource that affords everyday developers the ability to expand their products' reach easily. That's right, I said it, easily. Getting on the Epic Games Store continues to be an awesome, no-brainer option for expanding your product's reach. We understand. This is another platform, and not everyone has the additional resources to make the effort to onboard. So every day we work tirelessly on changing the perception of onboarding ease, improving the experience in using SPT, and spreading the word on how it can help make your game happen and be seen. Good news, it's working. So come and join the majority of developers using SPT to quickly announce their product, prepare their offers and builds for a clean review, distribute it, and earn an impressive revenue potential. Now keep in mind, the time it takes to move through the distribution process largely depends on a team effort of aligning on the product release plan, learning the requirements and guidelines, communicating expectations, and delivering complete and compliant submissions. So let's walk through some pro tips. First, sign up and product creation is a critical step. When onboarding a new product, be sure to think through the reach potential intended when implementing features like crossplay or multiplayer. Make sure you don't pigeonhole your players from not being able to play with their friends on as many platforms as possible and at the same launch time. Parity matters. Then communicate. Start amongst yourselves. Share what you know internally and align on how you want the product to show up. When to announce, launch, and where. And then complete the SPT product questionnaire, sharing what you know with us. We understand plans change, but having this information helps us plan for your product submissions and their release success expectations. Be sure to use available resources like the product checklist and the dashboard to track your efforts. Set up your team with permissions to the track progress and test together in dev portal. And if you run into any issues or have any questions, reach out. Start with our developer forum for a variety of support resources from Epic. We're here to help. Next, get noticed on all platforms. Aim to announce your product in parity to ensure it's seen. Make it happen easily by delivering assets and copy early. Providing early submissions makes it easier to have your page ready to go with time to localize. We provide localization services for free. I don't know if that's broadly known as it should be. So you should take advantage of this benefit by having your pages submitted in advance. And like other platforms, we have a set of requirements and guidelines for using assets, copy, and obtaining appropriate ratings for the regions the products will be distributed. So we aim to ensure a family-safe environment when reviewing our store catalog, so we require images and copy to not exceed the equivalent of an ESRB teen rating assignment. And note, EGS has IARC ratings integrated, meaning you can apply existing IARC ratings or obtain new ones right in self-publishing tool in a pretty slick way. And we encourage having rating assignments, not require it, in place to ensure the player experience will not be impacted by the content warnings or age gate treatments that are intended for unrated content. So be sure to review and learn the requirements in advance to avoid any surprises in your submission feedback. Then test. Test your product. Prepare your build by testing it to ensure it downloads and installs as expected. Ensure the EGS achievements have been configured and are published so that we can review them with the supplied build. And ensure crossplay operates as expected. Remember, a crossplay-enabled build must be provided at least 4 weeks prior to launch. The reason for this is it allows us sufficient time for independent testing and verification. And after testing, package your complete and compliant submission and push it to the staging sandbox for review and approval. You can expect an approval response of around 2 to 3 business days for a page submission and about 3 to 5 business days for a base product review. But again, keep in mind, if your build supports features like multiplayer, or crossplay, or even blockchain, we require more time. And for crossplay, it's 4 weeks. Remember that delivering quality submissions is truly the key to cruising to approval for launch. And while preparing for launch, there's a few common pitfalls that we recommend that you avoid to make sure that the experience isn't bumpy. Like completing your financial onboarding, making sure that the tax and payout inputs have been completed so that payouts are received seamlessly. And then keep your products coming soon page up to date. Make sure the release date stays accurate. And set a specific date to enable users to download the product once it's released. Finally, upon submission approval, remember, you push to live, not us. And that step, and those steps really, tend to be missed. So we look forward to adding alerts and notifications in SPT to help flag, remind users of outstanding next steps. After launching the product, consider expanding it, adding new features and updates. Follow the same keys to plan and communicate, test for launch readiness, deliver quality, and launch. And keep evolving your existing products and creating more. Remember, we're here to help along the way. Thank you. But now stay tuned and learn more about how to best promote your product.
Hi, everybody. I'm John Kopp. I'm the director of marketing here at the Epic Game Store. I apologize that you all have to listen to my terrible voice after Melissa's beautiful voice. I'm going to take you through promotions, campaigns, and digital merchandising. Those are the three things my team does for the most part. I'm also from New York. I talk really fast. I'm going to try to slow it down a little bit because I tend to rush through things. So hi. Like I mentioned, my name is John. By background-wise, I've been in the games industry since 2006. I joined the Epic Games Store in 2019. A lot has happened since then, so I'm excited to take you through it. Obviously, there was a big gap in there due to COVID. But we're back now, and we've got a lot of stuff to talk about. So I'm really pumped about this next section. So what do we do? What does my team do? Like I mentioned, promotions, campaigns, and digital merchandising. But I want to start first with your game's home on the store, your product detail page. The product detail page is your game's identity on the store. It's a place where players are going to make their purchase decision. So you really want to be informative, direct, and clear. You want to have quality gameplay assets to really show them what the game is all about. And you want to direct all your marketing here from day one. You want to put up your coming soon page as soon as you announce, and you want to really drive that wish listing because that's the key, that's the KPI for us on our side, and that's going to feed into a lot of our systems we're going to talk about here in a moment. On the right-hand side here, I got a quick example of the Alan Wake 2 PDP. I think they did a fantastic job. When I talk about updating, anytime you get an award or you get a nomination, you get something, put it on this page. It's a great indicator for people when they land there. Hey, I want to check that out. I want to see what that's all about. Next, I want to talk about wish listing features because this is very important. Players now have a dedicated wish list page that includes their Epic Rewards and their wallet up at the top on their balance so they can see how much money they could potentially save on some of these great titles they're following. There's filter and sort options so they can keep an eye on it, and it default sorts so that when a player goes in, any content they've wishlisted that's on sale is immediately at the top. That's letting them know, hey, this thing's on sale. You've been waiting for it. Why don't we make a purchase? There's also lifecycle notifications with opt-ins. You can see on the right side here from Nightingale, we've got an email that goes out. If you've wishlisted something and it changes its state when it goes to launch or it's on discount, those folks get a notification to let them know, hey, that product you were looking for is on sale. That's one way we're trying to help make those conversions for y'all. Next up, how do we drive sales and raise awareness? Store promotions. These are the type of epic campaigns that we have right now. On the right-hand side, we have our 10-pole campaigns. You may be familiar if you've seen the store. We have Mega Sale in the summer. We've got Holiday Sale in the wintertime. Those sales are usually our largest sales. They typically have additional incentives like giveaways, free games, free content packs, just to bring players in, get that daily churn. Those are typically 2-4 weeks long. They're high traffic. They bring in a lot of ton of new users, and like I mentioned, have lots of great incentives for folks. So we always invite people to get involved in that. If you've got content you want to throw in the mix, let us know. We're excited to work with you. Seasonal campaigns like peak season and special events. So I've got Lunar New Year in there as an example. We got summer sale, spring sale. Those are the ones that are kind of our tier two sales. They kind of run in between the larger tent poles. And then we've got our every week deals of the week. And so that's open to everybody. They can submit to that whenever they like. And we look at that list every week and we pull out two of our top forecasted titles. We put them on the front page. We put them on our sales and specials page. And they get tons of love. This has been a really positive program for us. We've seen a lot of success with our publishers. And because it's open every week, it gives you a lot of flexibility on when to discount your product. Lastly, we're working on something new. These are called Flex campaigns. These are going to be additional campaigns that run as a tertiary level. And these are basically, again, open to anybody. And they're here to give you more options, more flexibility in how you manage your product and your discounting cadence. We're hoping to get that out later this year. I believe we're targeting April. Don't hold me to that. Another couple types of promotions that we do are publisher and franchise sales. We doubled the number that we did from 22 to 23, which is really exciting. These are available by request because we do require some additional manual setup. You do have to provide the assets for us from the publisher or developer. But then once we have the space, we put it on our sales and specials page. If we have space on the homepage, we'll throw it there as well. And then these products that are part of these sales that are on discount also get pulled into our algorithmic sales blades around the store. And we'll talk a little bit more about those in a minute. We also cover industry and consumer events. If you're participating in one of these events, we're working with the showrunners. They give us a list. If the product is on the store, we include it in our roll-up. So we'll have a landing page, we'll have social, we'll have usually a blog that goes out and talks about a recap of everything that happened at the event. We actually just did the Dice Awards, which was fantastic. It was one of our top trending of the year, our top trending stories, so we're really excited about that. Like I said, if you're participating in the event, you're on the store, we can have you in these promotions. That's a lot of campaigns to manage, and we needed help. And so I want to introduce the discount management tool. Matt Sparks, who's on my team, is not here today. This was his lifelong dream of getting this thing done since the day he started. I'm so excited this thing is out. It puts you in control. It has direct scheduling by product, custom sales to fit your strategy, meaning if you don't want to opt into one of our sales, set up your own discount. That's fine. Store campaign opt-ins, which we'll talk about in a second, of what that looks like. And I'm not going to get too far into detail, but you can see here on the right side, this is what the actual interface looks like. So you can manage all of your products, what discount is on, if it's been approved by our team, if there's an issue with it that needs to be reset, that kind of thing. We do have a small moderation flow for it. It's nothing heavy. It's just to make sure, hey, is this the right number? Does it look weird? We'll contact you and say, hey, is this the right number? But for the most part, everything goes right through. If you want to learn more about it, we have our discount guide down here on the left as well. I'm going to have QR codes kind of peppered throughout here. Also, this deck is going to be available online later, so y'all have to take a bunch of notes, and you'll be able to get these QR codes, too. On the left-hand side, we've got our store campaign. So this is the browse of the opt-ins. You can see we've got a ton of sales there. Most of those are the deals of the week because they run every week. But we also have the seasonal sales, the 10 polls. They'll pop up there as well. This gives you the opportunity to leverage events to support your strategy. We have those 10 poll seasonal flex and deals of the week. And all of these options are open for experimentation. We highly recommend you experiment on a product-by-product basis to figure out what works for your products. Got a big catalog? No problem. We have batch uploads. You go in there, you download a CSV, a templated CSV. It's going to have all your product information in there. You put your percentages in, you re-upload, you're done. Talk a little bit about discount types real quick. So first of all, these are the ones that are available now. We have introductory offers, which are temporary price reductions up to 7 days from launch. You want to plan for these in advance. You want to make sure that it's in the system at least 24 hours before your release. Post-launch discounts or anything after that first 30 days of price establishment. Standard discounts like you might be familiar with. These are useful for store sales, events, and again, experimentation. Coming soon, we've got some new ones that are on the way in to SPT, through discount management tool. Pre-purchase offers are price reductions for the full pre-purchase window. These are ideal to incentivize early adopters. And we find they work best when paired with content incentives. We also typically see about 10 to 20%, just as a rough ballpark. Special offers are a combination of pre-purchase and introductory offer, because those are kind of complex price reductions. They have to have some additional messaging that goes out to players on the PDP. And so we're working on that right now. Those include the whole pre-purchase period and up to 7 days post-launch. So if you have like a 3-month pre-purchase and then you've got 1 week, you can have your launch discount. All right, so we've talked a little bit about the discounts, the types of discounts, types of campaigns. Where do we have these things? How do people discover these things? Our sales and specials hub. This is the first hub that we built. We're pretty excited about it. This is where we'll house all of our tentpole sales. You can see it's headlined by deals of the week at the very top. Publisher and franchise sales will be all populated here. You can see a breaker here for Hype Train. We'll also have any kind of special offers. So if we're doing something around Mega Sale and we have get a free content pack from Fortnite or get a free content pack from Warframe, that'll also show up on here. We'll have all of our current discounts are just below the fold here, so just below that, that breaker, you would see an entire collection of everything that's on sale in the store with filter options for you to check through. It links out to additional collections as well, but I'll tell you more about hubs in a little bit. So that brings me to my next point. How can we help players explore, find, and play the games they want? That's digital merchandising, my third team. Our approach to content programming is twofold. There's editorial and there's algorithmic. Editorial is essentially our team choosing content based on performance, trends, or business priority, whereas algorithmic is some sort of query that's driving that visual in the store. So typically we look at commercial, engagement, lifecycle, or geographic elements, and that's kind of what feeds into the different algorithms. Not going to get into a ton of detail. There is a QR code that will take you there in a second. But our Discover page is the first place that players may see your game, and I want to explain to you how that all works. Here's a breakdown of our Discover page. We're going to talk through a couple of definitions. That way we all start from the same place. So content modules are the building blocks of our layout. On the right side, I've highlighted each of these different content modules. Each one of those displays information and products a little bit differently. Some are editorial, and some are algorithmic, and some can be both. On the editorial side, this is a list of everything that is live currently on the store today. Anything with an asterisk is coming soon. Our team is actively working on them right now. Hopefully have them out in the next few weeks. Left side, homepage carousel, breakers, and blades like featured discounts or sales spotlight, Fortnite experiences, recently updated, or now on the Epic Store, are all editorial programmed. On the right side, we have algorithmic content modules, like our dynamic blades. Top new releases coming soon, games on sales coming soon. We launched trending a few months ago. Top selling add-ons is on the way. Most popular is already there. And we have most popular free-to-play and popular demos coming up soon. Dynamic list-wise, we have top sellers, most played, top upcoming wishlisted, new releases, top player rated, and coming soon. Some of these are very straightforward. Like those lists are pretty straightforward in terms of what you'd expect them to be and what they're going to be showing you. The other ones are a little bit more tuned. On the lower left side, there's that QR code I mentioned. If you're a registered developer, you can jump in there and you can see our P2B policy and you can have a better understanding of how things are showing up and where. If you're not familiar, platform to business policy is legislation out of Europe that wants to make sure that you have an understanding as the company's working with us, how your content shows up where and when. Hubs and collections, I want to talk about this. So hubs and collections are groups of themed content for players to explore, and I want to show you how those work. Hubs are a home for themed content with editorial and algorithmic collections. So for example, our sales and specials page, which we just showed you. We also have a free games page, and we also have our browse page. Those are the main hubs that we leverage today, and we are going to be looking to expand those, as Kyle mentioned. Navigation. Collection pages are editorial, algorithmic, or genre-based modules. So for example, Spring Sale is a manually programmed page. Most popular or action adventure. Most popular is driven by an algorithm, and action adventure is driven by tagging. So those are the three ways that we do those. Integrated campaigns, so just a quick touch point on this. Our team also has a campaign team. They manage all these integrated campaigns across our own channels. So we have social media, we have our Epic Game Store news, which is our blog. We have email newsletters and launcher notifications. On the right-hand side, you can see a recent campaign from our friends over at Rawmen. We're super excited. We have the carousel on the top left. We have an email on the right side. On the left, in the center, we have the blog post. And on the very bottom, we have a toast notification, which is the little launcher notification that pops up in the bottom right of your screen. I'm sure you're all very familiar with them if you've used the launcher. That was a lot. Let's recap some best practices. So first of all, I want to say start early and keep all your traffic pointed at your PDP, right? We want to see that coming soon page first. We want you to launch that as soon as you announce and keep that clean, updated, not only into launch, but through launch. Like I mentioned, those nominations, those awards, those other accolades that you might have. Tell players why they want to play your game. Drive traffic and wishlisting using all of your campaigns. From the day you start, drive everybody back to the PDP. That traffic is going to help drive your wishlisting. And then hopefully that feeds into our algorithmic programming. So it's informed by engagement metrics like traffic and wishlisting, and those increase your chances of getting featured in those placements. Next, I want you to remember leveraging store promotions to drive awareness and conversion. Join those sales and events that we talked about, participate, drive that awareness, experiment with your discounting as we talked about, that's what discount management tool is for, and then connect with our news team. If you've got some new announcements, you've got some exclusive you want to announce, like we are looking to break news, we are looking to create a news source for PC gamers. So if you have an opportunity, reach out to us, we're happy to work with you.